Good morning, and welcome to St. John the Evangelist Roman Catholic Church. Today, we celebrate the 23rd Sunday in Ordinary Time. Under the leadership of the Capuchin Franciscan Friars, and in union with the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Philadelphia, St. John's welcomes all who are present with us today in praising God and serving God's people. In this Eucharist, we remember especially the intentions of Father Tom. Our celebrant is Father Tom. As we are about to begin the liturgy, please turn off or silence all paging devices, cell phones, or any other devices that may be a cause of disruption or distraction during Holy Mass. Thank you.
Please rise and join me in singing our entrance hymn, number 598, Christ Be Our Light. Number 598, Christ Be Our Light.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My name is Father Tom. I know some of you. I lived in this friary for 21 years. I was on the staff of St. John's from 1991 to 1995, a long time ago. And for the past 6 years, I've been in Pittsburgh. But now I'm pastor. I'm grateful to Father John for all he did here, and I'm so happy to be home. I grew up in Pittsburgh, but Philadelphia is my home, and St. John's is my home. So I'm so happy to be back with you today, and for many years to come, please God. Let's begin our Mass today by remembering that God is good, that we're in God's presence. Remember that we are sinners, not worthy to be here, but that God loves us and invites us anyway.
Christ have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand
and receive adoption. Look graciously upon your beloved sons and daughters, that those who believe in Christ may receive true freedom and an everlasting inheritance. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. Who can know God's counsel, or who can conceive what the Lord intends? For the deliberations of mortals are timid, and unsure are our plans. For the corruptible body burdens the soul, and the earthen shelter weighs down the mind that has many concerns. And scarce do we guess the things on earth, and what is within our grasp we find with difficulty. But when things are in heaven, who can search them out? Or whoever knew your counsel, except you, had given wisdom and sent your Holy Spirit from on high. And thus were the paths of those on earth made straight. The word of the Lord.
Sleep. The next morning they are like
like the changing grass, which at dawn springs up anew, but by evening wilts and fades. In every age, O Lord, you have been our refuge. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain wisdom of heart. Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants. In every age, O Lord, you have been our refuge. Fill us at daybreak with your kindness, that we may shout for joy and gladness all our days. And may the gracious care of the Lord our God be ours. Prosper the work of our hands for us. Prosper the work of our hands. In every age, O Lord, you have been our refuge.
Before you listen to the second reading, I'd like to tell you about it so that when you hear it, you'll understand what's being proclaimed to you. This is a pretty important piece of the scripture. It's Paul's letter to Philemon. Now, the background of this letter is that Onesimus, who's mentioned in this letter, was Philemon's slave. And Onesimus ran away, and he met Paul. And Paul converted him to Christianity, and Paul came to really love this man, Onesimus. Now, Paul is sending the slave back to his master. Sounds a little disturbing in a way. From our 21st century perspective, he's sending the slave Onesimus back to Philemon, but he's telling Philemon he's no longer a slave, he's a brother. This passage is really one of the breakthrough passages in the New Testament where the scriptures tell us, and especially Paul, that because of Christ, the relationship between slave and master is no longer what it was. The slave is your brother. He's your equal. So listen to this reading, understanding what it's about.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to Philemon. I, Paul, an old man, and now also a prisoner for Christ Jesus, urge you on behalf of my child Onesimus, whose father I have become in my imprisonment. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I should have liked to retain him for myself so that he might serve me on your behalf in my imprisonment for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that the good you do might not be forced, but voluntary. Perhaps this is why he was away from you for a while, that you might have him back forever. No longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a brother, beloved especially to me, but even more so to you, as a man and in the Lord. So if you regard me as a partner, welcome him as you would me. The word of the Lord.
From the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Great crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and addressed them. If anyone comes to me without hating his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Which of you wishing to construct a tower does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if there is enough for its completion? Otherwise, after laying the foundation and finding himself unable to finish the work, the onlookers should laugh at him and say, "This one began to build but did not have the resources to finish." Or what king marching into battle would not first sit down and decide whether with 10,000 troops he can successfully oppose another king advancing upon him with 20,000 troops? But if not, while he is still far away, he will send a delegation to ask for peace terms. In the same way, any one of you who does not renounce all his possessions cannot be my disciple. The Gospel of the Lord. I was on vacation last week at the eastern shore of Maryland with four families, four couples, and each of the couples had children. So there were seven children there, and the oldest child was seven. So I spent a week with eight people, eight adults, and seven very active little children. After spending that week with these kids, I appreciate my vocation as a priest. And I also appreciate those of you who are parents, your vocation as parents. God bless you. One afternoon, we were going to Annapolis to ride on a pirate ship, which was a ship full of lots of children. Now you can imagine how much I was looking forward to this pirate ship with all those kids. And apparently they were going to be able to squirt cannons off the boat. And you know, I'll tell you why I didn't make it to the ship. But I went with one family, and when we got to Annapolis, their car broke down. So they had to call. He had to call AAA. And basically the battery was bad and he needed to replace the battery, and it took some time. So his wife and two children, they went with the other families onto the pirate ship. Now, we were hoping to get, you know, the battery replaced in time that we could make it. Well, he was hoping to get to the ship. I'm not so sure I was hoping for that. But anyway, it turns out that we didn't. So we didn't get to the pirate ship. So this man, this friend of mine, this father, he says to me, "I hate my kids, but now I miss them. I wish I could see them on that pirate ship." Now, he really doesn't hate his kids. And I was intrigued by the fact that in his jesting, he used the word hate. "I hate my kids, but I really miss them." He didn't hate his kids. And Jesus doesn't really mean that we should hate our mom and dad, our brothers and sisters, our spouse. But Jesus is saying something that's shocking. He's saying that all of our relationships in life, even the most important relationship, the intimacy of marriage, parenting, that all of this must be in light of our relationship with Jesus as his disciple. Now, I've heard people who said to me before, "You know, I want to be a disciple of Jesus, but I don't care what the Bible says. My family comes first. And if God can't understand that, well, that's God's problem. My family comes first." I've heard people say that to me. But I think they're missing the point of this, and I think they're also missing something of the point of discipleship. I want to tell you the story of a man, I think, whose life story illustrates, I think, a very important point that Jesus is making today. And that's Blessed Franz Jagerstatter. Blessed Franz Jagerstatter is declared blessed by the church, which is the level right before saint. He's on his way to being a saint. Have any of you ever heard of Franz Jagerstatter? You have? Yeah, okay. You're the only, this is my third Mass, and you're the only one who raised his hand, so I'm glad you know who he is. His story is remarkable. He was born in Austria in 1907. He was from a farming family. He was a bright boy, but, you know, in those days, his children didn't go to school beyond eighth grade. So after eighth grade, he left school and went to work on the family farm. He wasn't particularly religious in his teen years. In fact, he fathered a child illegitimately. He fathered a child outside of marriage. And he took care of that child the rest of his life, but he had a child by a woman, not his wife. And then in his late teen years, he had a religious conversion. He was a Catholic, but he became a firm Catholic. He married a good woman, and they had two children, girls, and they were farmers. Well, then Hitler took over Austria, and he was drafted into the Nazi army. He went off to basic training, and he was troubled by the fact that Hitler was who he is. And so he began to, there's a book I read a few years ago of his correspondence with his wife. So when you read the letters, he's not a well-educated man, simple guy, not prone to lots of emotional writing. But the first letters were about, you know, sell the pig and buy seeds from this store and see if this neighbor can help you harvest the crops, and a lot of stuff about farming and, you know, some telling her a little bit about what he's doing. But as time goes on, his tone changed. He became convinced that Hitler was evil, that Hitler was anti-God. Now, he didn't even know, it seems, about the concentration camps, and he didn't know how bad Hitler was. But he knew that this man stood against everything that his faith taught him. And at some point, he made up his mind he would not serve in Hitler's army. He would not wear the Nazi uniform. And he was put into prison. And his wife is now beginning to plead with him, you have two daughters. We need you. In fact, there's one picture of his daughters holding a sign that says, you know, come home, Daddy. And he's telling her, I can't have anything to do with that man. The Nazis made a generous offer to him. They offered to let him be a medic, to take care of wounded. And he said, no, I won't cooperate with Hitler in any way, shape, or form, because Hitler is from hell. And so his wife is begging him, think of your children. Your children need you. She's even telling him, if you go through with this and they kill you, what will happen to us? They may take our farm. Who knows what will happen to us? Think of us. He wouldn't. Shortly before he died, his wife went to see him, really a couple days before he was beheaded. He was guillotined. And the priest, his parish priest, went and with her, and the priest told him, you will go to hell if you follow through on what you're planning. First of all, you're disobeying the legitimate authorities, and secondly, you're abandoning your children. People who abandon their children are condemned by God. And this simple man stood up to his priest, told the priest he was wrong, told the priest, I won't submit, I will not cooperate with Hitler. His wife is pleading with him, but now she realizes there's no changing his mind. So the last day or so before he died, she wrote him a letter, a tender letter. Actually, I had a nightmare reading these letters, especially the last couple of letters. It disturbed my sleep one night. His wife basically realizing, you're going to die a martyr. I think you're wrong, but I want you to know I love you. And 2 hours before he died, he wrote her a letter back, again, a tender letter, and he was beheaded. Did he make the right decision? Should he have given in for the sake of his children? You know, he makes it clear in these letters that he's doing it for his children. Because basically what he understood is, if Hitler wins, and he thought that Hitler probably would win, Hitler is so anti-God, Hitler is so full of hate, that Hitler will take my daughters and he will take them away from God. Hitler will ruin my daughter's chance for salvation because he will control their minds. And his view was, I'd rather have my children know that their father died opposing Hitler, because that might give them a chance to understand how bad Hitler is. So, it was for his children that he served God by opposing Hitler and dying because of that opposition. It was for his family, according to his way of thinking. You know, Jesus is telling us that to be his disciple is going to cost you something. There's a price to be his disciple. And what I find for most of us is that we want to be disciples of Jesus, but we don't really want to pay a price for it. Many times we have many commitments, and we have lots of things we enjoy doing, and lots of things that we care about, and we want to add discipleship with Jesus. Add it to a whole lot of other commitments, and Jesus is saying it doesn't work that way. All your other commitments, all your other relationships have to be in light of your fundamental and primary commitment, which is to be my disciple. And being my disciple is carrying your cross. It's going to sometime cost you something. Has discipleship ever cost you anything? Have you ever sacrificed because you belong to Jesus? Other than going to church on Sunday morning, losing some sleep perhaps, or some leisure time, has it ever really cost you anything? I'm sorry, I can't say it's cost me much. I mean, I think that's a good question. Have you paid a price to be the disciple of Jesus? Jesus says it's like building a building. You have to know the cost before you start to build. And Jesus is saying this is a very costly building, discipleship. Are you willing to pay the price? As I said to you at the beginning of Mass, I'm happy to be back here at St. John's. And as I was returning to Philadelphia, lots of people said to me, Father, it's not like it was before you left. The pandemic changed everything. Fewer people working in Center City, fewer people coming to Center City, fewer people at Mass. The weekday Masses are almost nobody, handful of people. The Sunday Masses are certainly diminished from what they were 6 years ago. I can see that looking at you today. They also told me Center City is not as safe as it used to be. Lots of drugs, lots of people who are homeless, lots of risks to be in Center City. Well, Jesus is calling you and me to be disciples here. Here, now. Jesus is asking this church community to be his here and now. He's not asking us to long for the good old days before COVID, or the good old days when things were calmer or there was more peace and less violence. Looking back to a golden age is not ever the call of Jesus. Jesus is asking us to be his disciples here and now, 2022 and beyond. And so Jesus is asking us to work together to be his light, his presence in this place, in this time, and in the time to come. So we have to think together, you and I, about how we can have a vibrant, healing community of faith here at St. John's. Not what was, but now. Now. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In order to be his disciples and to do what we must do, we need his help. We're incapable on our own of serving the Lord and belonging to him. So let's pray for the graces we need to witness to his faith here and now in our lives and in our times.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer, that those who have dedicated their lives in serving Christ in the church may be blessed with strength and perseverance to remain faithful to their promises. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are traveling this Labor Day weekend, that they arrive at their destination safely. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the hungry, the poor, the sick, the suffering, and the homeless, may God graciously provide for their every need. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For catechists and all who pass on the faith, may the Holy Spirit fill them with knowledge and wisdom to share God's truth. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, may they live in the light and peace of God's presence in heaven forever. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions in our book of prayer and those that each of us offers now in silence, and for the intentions of Father Tom, remembered especially in this Eucharist, in faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Let's ask our Blessed Mother to pray with us as we sing, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of death. Amen. And all of these prayers we present to the Father through Christ our Lord.
Please join in singing our offertory hymn number 499, Only This I Want. Number 499, Only This I Want.
Let's pray.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
O God, who give us the gift of true prayer and of peace, graciously grant that, through this offering, we may do fitting homage to your divine majesty, and by partaking of the sacred mystery, we may be faithfully united in mind and heart through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. And all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. John the Evangelist, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit.
Let's now greet each other with a sign of God's peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Please join me in singing our communion hymn number 337, One Bread, One Body. Number 337, One Bread, One Body.
Grant that your faithful, O Lord, whom you nourish and endow with life through the food of your word and heavenly sacrament, may so benefit from your beloved Son's great gifts that we may merit an eternal share in his life, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please join in our recessional hymn number 745, America the Beautiful, number 745, America the Beautiful.
Just wanted to really enjoy it.